Horizon Roundtable. I am Bob McDonald, and joining me is my co-host, Matt Dudek.
Hey there, everybody.
Matt, you can find on Twitter at Horizon Matt. You can find us on the web at horizonroundtable.com. You can find links to all of our social sites and podcast sites where you can find us at horizonroundtable.com/subscribe. Become a patron, patreon.com/horizonroundtable. And Matt, seems like it's been a while for you and me.
Who are you again? Do I know you?
All right. Well, I had to bring you into this because obviously we had a number of different coaching changes. Joining us today is the new head coach at Youngstown State, Ethan Faulkner. Coach, thank you very much for joining us. Really appreciate you having you on.
Appreciate you guys having me. Excited to talk some hoops.
Right.
Isn't that just a great thing to be able to start talking hoops already? Like I'm so ready for college basketball season.
I never stopped. All right. So coach, first question, what was your reaction when you got the call to take the head coaching job, and how did it feel that Youngstown State moved so quickly in promoting you once Jared Calhoun took the gig at Utah State?
Yeah, obviously really, really excited. I think, you know, when you get into coaching, you know, I think most people's end goal is to someday have an opportunity to be a head coach. And I think with the success that we've had here at Youngstown is, you know, got people really, really excited about our program. I think the most rewarding part about it, Bob, was, you know, our players really went to bat for me. We had, you know, six guys that were returning that had eligibility. All those guys, you know, really, really went to bat for me. And I think that speaks to the relationships that we really try to build with our players here in Youngstown.
Yeah.
And I think one of my first questions for you, Ethan, is you are one of the younger, if not the youngest, but one of the younger coaches now within Division I. So, you know, do you think that gives you an advantage with some of these guys that are returning and starting to recruit? And we know we'll talk about the portal a little bit, I'm sure, and how that's playing out for you. But being kind of one of the younger guys within college hoops, do you think that's an advantage for you now?
Yeah, I don't know if it's an advantage or a disadvantage. I think something to speak to that point that I've really tried to do is add some guys to our staff with a lot of experience. You know, two former head coaches on our staff. That's, you know, going to help me navigate some of these waters that I've been in. But, you know, I do think that, you know, players are different now than maybe even when I started coaching 10, 11 years ago. And I think the relationship aspect of it is so important. And maybe, you know, that could play into being able to, you know, strengthen some relationships with players in terms of maybe being a younger head coach, maybe having more of a new school mentality in terms of what it takes to build chemistry and build culture and get guys to really buy into what you're trying to accomplish.
You know, it's weird because Bob's kind of the elder statesman of the Horizon Roundtable. So, you know, we often talk to coaches that are, you know, younger than Bob, but I don't get to very often. So it's kind of fun for me.
Sure.
Gee, thank you for reminding me. I turned 50 soon. Appreciate that, dude. One question that I actually had, Coach, we have Paul Corsaro, who's the new coach at IUND, on the podcast a couple of months ago. He reminded us that he, as a part of the U of Indy roster when he was playing, had an opportunity to play against you while you were at Northern Kentucky. He also made mention that you were much better than he was. Have you had the opportunity to talk to him since you got the job, and what's it going to be like to play against him this time as coaches?
Yeah, you know, I've known Paul for a long time. Obviously, competed against him as athletes when we were playing. And, you know, I think Paul's a really good coach. I think he's going to, you know, really take that program to another level. And I think that's what's going to be interesting about our league is with so many coaching changes, obviously tons of roster turnover. You know, I think it's going to be a kind of a new look league. But I think our league is going to be as good as it's been in a long time. Obviously, last year, a lot of really, really good teams. You know, if you look at the teams 1 through 9 in the standings last year, you know, I think any of those teams and maybe even some of the other ones had an opportunity to really compete for that Horizon League championship. So certainly going to be a different look in our league this year with new coaches and roster turnover. So excited about those challenges ahead.
Go ahead, Matt.
I was going to say, you talk about the league and you have kind of an interesting perspective on the league. Not only have you been a coach in the league, but as a former player at Northern Kentucky, and we talk a lot about Horizon on Horizon Crime. Can you just talk about your perspective kind of with both of, you know, your intimacy to both of those schools and what that tells you about the league?
You know, it's interesting, Matt, when I was playing at Northern Kentucky, we actually weren't in the Horizon League. We were in the Atlantic Sun. But in terms of the coaching, aspect of it, I think our league continues to get better and better. I've been in the league now for 5 years and just continue to watch teams grow. Obviously, the momentum of our program has really shifted in the last 5 years. You've got your staples in the league with Northern Kentucky and Wright State and Oakland and so many others that are just so good year after year. And I think it's just going to continue to improve. New coaches at IUPUI, new coaches at Detroit, and new coaches at Wright State kind of in the same boat as us in terms of somebody taking over that's been there in their program. So excited about, our league continuing to get better and better. And in reality, it helps every team in the league when the strength of the league is so well when it comes time to get to the NCAA tournament and moving up seed lines. You've seen it with Oakland this year. I think the goal for all of us is not just to get there, but to be able to compete and have a chance to win games there. And I think you're going to continue to see us compete at a really, really high level across the country.
All right. I'll take the opportunity since you brought it up. I am, kind of the resident, one of the resident Oakland guys. And can you just talk a little bit about, being a coach within the league, and watching what Oakland did and what that does for the league? What does that do for, your recruiting and just being able to talk about the league in that perspective?
Yeah, it raises our league's brand across the country. Oakland, obviously what a special year they had. And, I've got to know those guys, their staff a little bit because Coach Campion and Coach Calhoun were so close. They're really close friends. And, obviously the experience that Coach Campy has, not just in this league, but across college basketball and what he's been able to do there, really, really special. And obviously last year they should have been in the Sweet 16, right? So it was special to see that them do what they did and really give us confidence that once we get the opportunity to knock that door down and get to the NCAA tournament, that we'll be able to get there and compete.
Kind of to piggyback off of Matt's question about your experience in Northern Kentucky, talking about you playing at Northern Kentucky and also serving as an assistant under Dave Beasel. My question is, what lessons did you take away from him as he was as coach at Northern Kentucky from that time that you carry into today?
Yeah, certainly would not be where I'm at today without Coach Bees. I mean, I don't know that anybody in my career has had any more belief in me, not just as a player, but as a coach. But I think if we could go back in time and we could go back to a Northern Kentucky practice under Dave Beasel, things that would really stand out is the discipline, the toughness. Certainly was a defensive minded guy. And, I've kind of carried that with me, up until, last year, most of my time spent coaching had been on the defensive side of the ball. And so much of what I learned from him was things that I had carried with me, all the way through my coaching career. But just a really, really special person to me, gave me an opportunity at 23 years old to be a Division I assistant coach with no experience, a guy that thought he knew everything about everything and really didn't know anything about anything. And just really, really taught me what it was like to be a coach. And just even at that time, give me the freedom to and the responsibilities to really grow as a coach early on in my career.
Talking about the coaching additions that you brought in, one of the coaches that you brought in, you first announced it during the press conference, your introductory press conference as head coach, is your twin brother Evan, who comes over from Pikeville. And I understand this is the first time you two have coached together at the college level.
Sure.
So what has it been like for you having that opportunity to work together this time around?
Yeah, Evan's going to be a integral part of our athletic department, but not just him. I really feel like we've really added and put together a staff that really complement one another. Again, I talked about adding Dwayne Osborne, one of the best Division II coaches in the country over the last 15 years. Coach Mark Richmond, another guy with Division II head coaching experience, had been on our staff at Youngstown when Coach Calhoun first got here. Going to be vital to our success. Was really, really important for me to be able to retain Danny Reese, who's just been an integral part of every step that we've taken in this program. Anthony Johnson coming to us from Ole Miss, going to be a guy that brings incredible value. So I think the biggest thing about our staff is we've added some real experienced guys with that's won a lot of games as head coaches, guys that bring different perspectives from different levels of college basketball. And again, I just think we really, really complement each other well, and we've got really good staff chemistry. These are guys that I've known for a long, long time. I think it's certainly important to surround yourself with people that you really, really trust.
And how have they kind of acclimated, specifically the new guys, Evan and Dwayne Osborne and Anthony Johnson, obviously, Danny Reese and Mark Richmond are really with the Youngstown State landscape. How have the new guys acclimated to this landscape?
Yeah, I think we just hit the ground running, right? I mean, that's, we were in a situation where, when the coaching change happened was right when the portal was opening up. So Coach Reese and I were a two-man crew for about 2 weeks, and felt like we were doing the work of about 10 people. And then as we continue to add guys and get guys here to our staff, they just, again, just hit the ground running. We had a lot of recruiting to do in terms of, the transfer portal. And we actually signed a high school kid late. We signed some junior college players. So, again, we just kind of hit the ground running, got our roster filled. And then as the summer has progressed, I really feel like we've made progress with our team in terms of building some relationships, trying to establish what we want this thing to look like from a culture standpoint, and really trying to get a foundation in here offensively and defensively on what we want it to look like.
So with that, what can we expect to see from Youngstown? It's been a lot of, I feel, offense, but you talk that you're, a defensive-minded coach. Are we going to see a shift in kind of the Youngstown State mentality? Like, what can we expect to see from your team on the floor this year?
A lot of the same, Matt. It's to me, if it's not broke, don't fix it. Obviously, we've had tons of success when you look at what we've done offensively over the last 2 years, top 20 in the country in scoring, made some real, real progress defensively. I think certainly Gabe Dines and Iman Zorval give us, a different perspective defensively than we've had in years past with their ability to really protect the rim. So a lot of it's going to remain the same. The things that we're trying to do offensively, what I believe in offensively is a lot of what I've learned from Coach Calhoun over the last 5 years. So you're going to see really a style of play that's very, very similar to what we've had in years past.
One player that you have to replace that was actually probably my favorite player to watch in the entire Horizon League was Burns. I called him Tigger because the guy he was constant energy and just movement. How do you replace a player like that? Or can you, or do you just kind of fill that void a little bit?
Yeah, it's interesting because I think our forwards at that position will look a little bit different this year. DJ was kind of an undersized five that had a lot of versatility. That's really the only position that we didn't recruit this year, which tells you that we feel really good about Gabe Dines and Iman Zorgvall. And we had a young man that was redshirting last year, Christian Kirkland, to really kind of fill that void of DJ. But it's certainly going to be, a combination of those three guys trying to replace his production. But I can tell you Gabe Dines and Iman have made great, great strides in their improvement this offseason. We feel really good about where they're at.
I mean, when you do have a couple of 7-footers, it does make that a little bit easier, I assume.
you know, those guys are going to be counted on heavily. I think Gabe Dines can really, really make a huge jump in his sophomore year. A guy that, again, just continues to improve at a rapid pace. It's interesting, when we recruited Gabe, we fully expected him to be a redshirt last year, but he got here and he worked his tail off. He gained about 30 or 35 pounds in his first off season. He's up to about 240 now, which has been critical for his development. Just a guy that just, as soon as he got on campus, just his growth and his development was at a rapid pace. And we feel like that's really continuing into this offseason, and expect Gabe to be an all-league caliber player.
Yeah, I've seen some pictures of some videos of Dines over in the offseason. He's going to be scary. And not to take anything away from Zorkball, he's no slouch himself, but yeah, Dines is going to be scary next year.
Yeah, both those guys. I think, at our level, they just give us unique size, right? I mean, both Iman 7 foot, Gabe 7'3". And, at a lot of times at our level, when you have guys like that, they're really projects or development guys that, take several years to get to a point where they can really contribute at a high level. But, both of their improvements have been really fun to watch. And again, we expect those two guys to be really, really good players for us.
One other, you mentioned Kirkland, you mentioned, you obviously mentioned Iman and Dines. One additional part of the roster from last year that's coming back is EJ Farmer. Mm-hmm. And given that combination of those guys, and also obviously David Wilkerson is going to be a part of this group too. We didn't get a chance to see him last year. How important is it to have this core of veteran players coming in, yeah, as you are bringing in these new faces to the roster?
Yeah, it's funny as we think about the landscape of college basketball. We've got six guys returning from our roster from last year, and we feel like that's a lot. Right, we feel like we actually have some continuity, and we've just got six players returning. But it's kind of the day and age of college basketball that we're in, where a lot of years you don't have that much continuity. But obviously, Gabe, Iman, EJ, all those guys played, minutes for us last year and contribute to our team. David, as we get him healthy, he's going to be a really, really good player. We recruited him last year, expecting him to be a guy that could compete for a starting spot on our team. 6'4" point guard, kind of a throwback point guard who can really run your team, get other people shots, score when his opportunities come. All of those guys are going to be counted on heavily for our team as we mix in nine new players into our roster. So we're excited about what our roster looks like. Think we've got a team that can certainly compete at the top of the league.
You talk about the new guys who are coming in, and I want to circle back to the transfer portals, because it has been, especially during your time as an assistant, a big part of YSU's roster building and eventual success the last 2 years. Now that you're at the top job, has there been any changes to that strategy from when you were an assistant?
No, much of our recruiting philosophy has stayed the same. Obviously, we attacked the portal really hard this year, bringing in seven transfers. We actually also added two high school players, so in total, nine new guys. If you look at the breakdown, I think what is a little bit different than maybe in years past is we've kind of attacked it from all levels of college basketball, not just Division I transfers. We've got three Division I transfers, an NAIA transfer, two junior college players, and then a Division II transfer that is adding. So, we did attack it a little bit differently in terms of, not just taking all Division I transfers this year like we did last year, but all these guys, bring different things to the table that are really going to impact our team.
When you talk about, transfer portals and recruiting and all that, one thing that Youngstown has been working on that I'd love to get an update on is what's the status of the Bigley Center transformation, and where's that at? I know that was a big project for Youngstown and Jared Calhoun the last couple of years.
Yeah, really excited about what we've got going on. So, our project really started last year. We put about $900,000 into a brand new athletic training room. Moving forward into this off season, total gym renovation of the Beagley Center, brand new locker room. We've got a new academic center as well. So it's kind of been a four-part project that we've been working on over the last couple of years. But we've been out of Beagley in our practice facility all summer as they make the renovations. But it's going to be really special. It's something that's been long overdue for our program. Our gym is something that's certainly needed an upgrade. And I think once we get this all finalized with the Beagley and our locker room, we're going to have as nice a facility as anybody in our league.
I love to hear that because, as you see a lot of the other programs within the league upping their game, the facility that Milwaukee has put together, Oakland is working on a facility. So I'm sure that just helps with recruiting to have that stuff in place.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, it's so many things that go into recruiting and certainly your facilities are one of them. And, we're going to be competing right at the top in terms of that once we get our gym done this summer. And we expect, our volleyball team obviously plays inside the Beagley Center and their season starts before us. So, we expect that to be done by the time volleyball season comes around.
Now, the renovations and everything that's been going on with Youngstown State, obviously the foundation of that has been the community through donors and things along that lines. And obviously that has a huge impact specifically with improvements to the facilities, as well as now we're in the landscape of NIL. Obviously that's going to be a big contributor as well. As you move forward, How is that relationship with the community going to grow even more? Obviously, at this point in time, Youngstown State has a real core of fans that weren't maybe necessarily there maybe 6-7 years ago, and they're there now. What is your expectation working with those that group of fans and potential donors? How is that going to grow moving forward as you can see it?
Yeah, I can't say enough about our community and the support that they've given our program over the last 5 years. Youngstown's a unique place. It's a place that loves a winner, a place that wants to have a good basketball team, a good women's basketball team, a good football team, and they're all in. I think we have a unique home court advantage, especially for the mid-major level. When you're talking about playing in Horizon League games and we've got, sometimes upwards of 5,000 fans here, it really gives us a real home court advantage. And I think if you look at what we've done at home in terms of our win-loss record over the last 5 years, you can see that we have a real home court advantage here. But we've developed some really, really good relationships since I've been here with our supporters, and they've continued to support us as throughout the coaching change. And I don't anticipate any of that changing. It's a place that's really all in on seeing us be as successful as we can possibly be. And that's whether that's financial contributions or whether that's season ticket sales or whether that's coming to the games. All those things have been really, really special to see from our community.
And kind of going with that, Youngstown has something that's different than any other school in the Horizon League, where they do have a active, successful football program. What does that change for you? Do you feel like that's more of an advantage because you have, kind of that football fan base, that'll not only football fan base, that Ohio football fan base already built in, and you just kind of shift them over to you? Do you feel like you have to kind of work within that? Like, what is that relationship like for you as a coach?
No, it's Doug and I have a good relationship, and he's done a fabulous job, kind of getting our football program back to competing at a really, really high level. And I think, it's an advantage for us. When we bring recruits in on football weekends and there's 10,000-12,000 fans at our football games, and they get a real college atmosphere on those weekends. It's certainly been beneficial to us. And, you know, I think football winning helps basketball win. I think basketball winning helps football win. So, you know, it's something here that is unique from the other teams in our league, with us being the only team in the league with a football team. So I think it certainly helps us.
You mentioned, I'm glad you mentioned previously about you talked a little bit about, when talking about the community, talking about the women's basketball team. They are also in a situation where they're bringing in a new coach. Melissa Jackson is the new head coach, came over after spending a year at Cleveland State as an assistant. Have you what kind of conversations since you're both new to the head coaching jobs, your respective jobs at Youngstown State, have you had any conversations about that transition, and you know, what has that relationship been like since both of you have been on board?
Yeah, Melissa's been great to work with. I think she's a really, really good basketball coach. I think she's gonna continue to take our women's program to new heights. Obviously, our women's program's had a lot of success under Coach Barnes. So I feel like their program's in a really good spot. And Melissa's been great to work with. You know, obviously, getting to know her better, we both kind of been here for, you know, 2 or 3 months. And obviously, both of us are very, very busy. So it's not like we're, you know, having deep conversations every day about X's and O's, or about how they're doing things, or about how we're doing things. But, you know, she's been very good to work with, and I think she's going to do a really good job with our women's team.
For you coming in, you know, as you were already there, you know the program, you know a lot of what's going on. But as you've moved into that head coaching position, what's one thing that's kind of caught you off guard or surprised you, or, you know, given you a new appreciation, if I could speak this morning, a new appreciation for like what Jared was doing before you, that you're like, oh man, now this falls on me as head coach?
Yeah, I've told everybody that's asked me that, you go from the guy that's making the suggestions to the guy that's making the decisions, right? So, but again, I think with our staff, we've really developed some great chemistry, and this is certainly a collaborative effort. It's just not a dictatorship with our coaching staff, and I think that's why it was so important for us to add people that really complement one another, add some real experienced guys that's been in my chair and made those decisions before. And, you know, obviously there's things that have come up that, you know, I've never had to think about before that I'm having to think about now. So, but for the most part, been a smooth transition.
So one question that I have is related to some of the interconference rivalries. You've seen them, you know, throughout the league. You know, Northern Kentucky and Wright State is a big one, of course. The Green Bay Milwaukee rivalry got pretty spicy last season. I've always been I'm a Cleveland State guy, I'll admit it. I've always been thinking that there could be is that rivalry between Cleveland State and Youngstown State could be a thing. And also, too, you know, Youngstown State and Robert Morris. When you look at kind of that landscape, is there a little bit of a obviously you're going to have a lot of competitive juices flowing within the league, but when you see, you know, some of those, you know, teams that are closer to Youngstown State, like a Cleveland State or a Robert Morris, is there a little bit more incentive to be able to beat those teams, as you've experienced playing those teams as an assistant, but now as a head coach, does that kind of grow a little bit more as in the, you know, the need to, you know, best those rivals?
Yeah, obviously there's some really good regional rivalries in our conference. And you know, I think from a coaching standpoint, you approach every game the same. If you think about it, maybe from our fan standpoint, you know, the Cleveland States for us, the Robert Morris, the regional teams. I'm sure if you would ask our fans, those games may mean a little bit more to them. But if you look at how competitive our league has been over the last several years, every game is so important. when you're talking about trying to win a regular season championship. So I think from a coaching standpoint, you're approaching every game with the same mentality and just trying to put your team in the best position to have success. But I would say from a fan standpoint, especially here in Youngstown, the Cleveland State game, the Robert Morris game, and even you know, the traditional powers in our league, the Wright States and the NKUs, those games, you know, probably weigh a little heavier on our fans than maybe our coaching staff, because again, as a coaching staff, you're trying to win every game.
Sure.
All right, but let's be honest here. Which trip do you look forward to from a food standpoint, and which gym that's not the Bigley Center within the league do you look forward to? Do you just find it to be a great atmosphere?
Well, I would say probably the trip that I look forward to the most, and it's simply for one reason, is the NKU trip. And it's because I have so many relationships in that area. It gives me a chance to get back to where I spent 6 years of my life and, you know, really catch up with some people that are close to me and still got a lot of friends in the area that went to college with, different things like that. So obviously rarely do I ever get to do that except for when we're making that trip. So I do look forward to that trip and just the challenge of playing against a really good team, right? Obviously NKU's been one of the better teams in our league for the last several years. So I would say for those two reasons, getting down to that area is fun for me.
All right, but what's your Skyline order?
Skyline would be a four-way and a cheese cone, everything on it.
I mean, if you've ever listened to this podcast, or, you know, we always got to talk food with coaches. I blame Greg Campy, but like, we got to always know what people are eating. We know what's out there for us.
Absolutely. Well, I can tell you this, if we're talking food, the Youngstown area is hard to beat.
What's the go-to? Because Corsero was telling us about the Italian places, you know, in Indy and all that.
That's so true.
What
you got?
So we have a place in town, an Italian place, and the guy that owns it is a big supporter of us. It's Acquapazzo, really, really high-level Italian restaurant. And there's many, many others here in Youngstown that are really, really good places to eat.
Do you have any other questions, Matt?
No, I mean, at the point that we're broken down basketball and food, what more is there?
Clearly not. All right. Well, Coach, thank you once again for joining us. Tell everybody where we can find you online.
Okay, on Twitter, it's at CoachFaulkner1. You guys, I'm not a huge social media guy. I'll have to look up what my Instagram handle is. It's at Coach Faulkner one as well, or Faulkner Ethan one on Instagram, and at Coach Faulkner one on Twitter.
All right. And that's going to wrap it up for us. Until next time, you can find all of our episodes and all of our written content at horizonroundtable.com. You can find us where podcasts are found. And, of course, you can find it, pull us up on your Amazon or Google devices. So until next time, not sure where that's going to be, but we're getting close to slowly getting close to the season getting here. But until then, thank you all for listening.